Omdat je aan het iemand de sjaals aan slaagstukken, seksueel militant in haar pas, maar is ik ook weer maar. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Pushkaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Namini. Namaste Sarasvata Devi Gauravani Pacharini. Nirvishesha Srinivasa Paschacharya Tathagata. Srila Prabhupada Ki. So today we have today we will discuss Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, Chapter 47, Verses 54 till 69. So Uddhav will express at the end his appreciation for the love of the gopis. And verses 58 till the end is called, we can say Uddhav Gita, he sang the verses, it is said that a mini Uddhav Gita. But before we are going into this last section, because we have been with mostly concerned in this verse. In this chapters that we read, the last chapters, about the depth of the gopis' love for Krishna. Now, Jiva Goswami, he speaks about that love of the Raja gopis. In his commentary on the Srimad Bhagavatam Chaturshloki, I read the third verse of the Srimad Bhagavatam Chaturshloki, 2.9.36. Etava, just a moment, etavat eva jichnasyan tatvar jichnasunatmana amvya vyatreka vyam yatshat sarvata sarvada. A person who is searching after the absolute truth, the personality of God, that most certainly search for it up to this in all circumstances, in all space and time, and both directly and indirectly. Searching after Krishna means we are in separation, we are feeling separation. So, hinting at that, Jiva Goswami explains that this, or gives his commentaries on this third verse of the Srimad Bhagavatam Chaturshloki. And this in relation to the 10th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. So using the Srimad Bhagavatam 10th canto and its verses, many verses he refers to, as the main reference for his Krishna Sandarbha, there in Krishna Sandarbha Anucheda 154, Jiva Goswami wonderfully describes the exalted states of prema bhakti that the Braja gopis possess. By virtue of their powerful love of Krishna, they remain constantly in Krishna's association. Interestingly, in Anucheda 154, he offers a quotation from Srimad Bhagavatam, and he quotes verse 10.47.29. I will read that first. Just a moment. 10.47. Yeah. The Supreme Lord said, you are never actually separated from me, for I am the soul of all creation. Just as the elements of nature, ether, air, fire, water and earth are present in every created thing, so I am present within everyone's mind, life, air and senses, and also within the physical elements and the modes of material nature. So he offers this, he quotes this verse to express the saharasya meaning, or that means the most esoteric meaning and the most secret meaning of the third verse of the Srimad Bhagavatam Chaturshloki. So in here is Anucheta 56, should be 156, that I will read it for you. Commentary of Siva Goswami, this third verse of the Srimad Bhagavatam Chaturshloki. Superficially describing the all-pervading super-soul, Lord Krishna actually describes the gopis' constant meditation on him and their uninterrupted svarasika perception of him. So he used this word svarasika. Svarasika means, and this, yeah, means, and of course, this is the highest stage of bhakti. But svarasika means where Krishna manifests in one's consciousness and performs pastimes in one's heart or in one's consciousness. So that's important to understand that in relation to this entire chapter also. And therefore I will repeat it. This svarasika means where Krishna manifests in one's consciousness and performs pastimes in one's heart or in one's consciousness. They had constantly uninterrupted svarasika perception. So it was going on all the time. They had uninterrupted svarasika perception of him through strong feelings of separation. So the strong feelings of separation that was required to get this svarasika perception, this constant seeing of Krishna's pastimes manifested in one's mind consciousness. So I say consciousness, not mind. That material mind is not suitable for that. It's a spiritual experience in the consciousness, which is quite different from mental experiences. The spiritual experiences come straight in the consciousness, in the pure consciousness of the soul. So in the following verse, 10:47:29, that verse I just read, but I repeat it again. My dear gopis, just as the five material elements as earth, water, fire, air and ether, all pervading in the material world and present in the bodies of all living entities. In the same way, I am also present within you. I am in your mind, your senses, and your life breath. I have taken shelter in all these places. So Krishna says, here, I have taken shelter in all these places. That is text 29, yeah. 29, yeah. I've taken shelter there. Shiva Goswami is describing how Krishna is not separate from the gopis at any time. He's constantly with them because he has taken shelter in their mind, senses, body and prana. He has actually taken shelter in those places of the Braja gopis due to their own uninterrupted longing for them. So that is Krishna's reciprocation with their longing, with their intense desire, their intense desire to be with him, feelings of separation. Sri Krishna's statement, Shiva Goswami explains, can be interpreted in the following way. This is a little explanation of this verse, that 29. The material elements are causes of one another, as mentioned in the third canto, that is, either is a cause of air, air of fire, fire of water, and water of earth. Each element's cause is situated in its effect. This is a principle of nyaya, or logic, that there is a part of the cause always in the effect. That's nyaya, logic. That this is because the effect comes from the cause. So everything comes from Krishna, ultimately. Means everything is Krishna, his ultimate cause. At least in terms of his energies, not in the term of Bhagavan. This is Acintya, Veda Veda Tattva. So one can understand this, that Krishna is, who is the cause of everything, is therefore situated in everything. The cause is always situated in the effect. So Krishna continues, this is the explanation of Shiva Goswami further. Even though we have been externally separated, I will always remain within you. Thus I am eternally situated in all of you, although I am not externally perceived as such. That, it appears that this explanation is just speaking about the super soul, that Krishna is through his expansions present in the effect. So, it's just speaking about the super soul, because everything is ultimately an expansion of Krishna. So Krishna says that I'm actually there, although I'm not externally perceived as such. Then the question could be asked, in which way am I within you? So Krishna replies, I'm the refuge of the minds of you who are my only life. Refuge means that I'm the shelter of your minds who are my only life. He's saying that your minds are always sheltered in me. You are always thinking of me. They are not going anywhere. Anywhere else, their minds of the gopis were not diverted for a moment. And you are my only life. You are my prananat, the life of Krishna's life. Because of separation from me, even for a moment, your minds would not be able to exist. Or an answer on the expected question in which form you are situated in us, and Krishna answered only in that two-handed form. So he's not there in a four-handed form as a super soul. In their minds there is only Krishna. The gopis, only in that form, that is the two-handed dark complexion, and plays the flute. In that form, I'm the refuge of all your minds. In Anucheta 155, Srila Jiva Goswami states, although the gopis seem to be separated from Krishna in his Prakat Lila, manifest pastimes, they were always thinking of him and thus perceived his presence directly in his Aprakat, unmanifested pastimes. So Srila Vishvanathaswami Thakur explained this in great depth, how there are two different manifestations. In one, there is a separation from Krishna, and those in separation from Krishna, there are three different categories. We heard this before, about these three categories, but that was brought up before in the previous chapter with Shiva Goswami in his commentary, and it's repeated here. These three categories are, first, the unintelligent or unconscious, practically speaking, such as the animals, and they are directly perceiving Krishna's presence, even in his uppercut, because they love him so much in separation, they have full access to his uppercut lila. So even the animals in Vrindavan, always absorbed in uppercut lila, through feelings of separation. And the second category is the cowboys, who are very trusting. Cowboys is the second category, because they trust Krishna. And they also experience Krishna as with them or at all times. So they enter also this uppercut lila. And then there are the eager, anxiety-full ones. These are the parents and the gopis. These are the ones in the prakrat manifestation, where there is separation. They actually experience separation, but in that separation, they are experiencing Krishna in that separation and get their access to the uppercut lila also. Being situated, Srila Jiva Goswami continues in the states of Svarasakhi realization. So it is Svarasika. Yes. And just repeat again. Svarasika perception is when Krishna manifests in one's consciousness and performs pastimes in one's heart or in one's consciousness. So being situated in that state of Svarasika realization, Krishna is always manifesting his pastimes in their hearts. Constantly. Constantly the gopis thought of Krishna. In all my manifestations you have been separated from me, actually doesn't take place. The separation occurs in my manifest pastimes. The prakrat lila, union with me exists simultaneously in my unmanifest pastime, the aprakat lila. So that's what gives one's access to the aprakat lila, where there is meeting with Krishna, is the intense mood of separation that was possessed by the residents of Vrindavan. So Jiva Goswami continues. And at the time, during separation, the union of the gopis with me is within my unmanifest pastimes in Vrindavan. Although Krishna does go somewhere else in Vrindavan, in Mathura and Dwarka, he does that in his manifest pastimes, his prakrat lila. In Srimad Bhagavatam, 10.47.29, again this verse 29, where Krishna says that I am the cause of everything and the cause is in the effect. So he says in that verse, it's clear that it is not possible for you to be separated from me. Krishna says, it's not possible. You are not actually separated from me. It is not possible because the cause manifests through its effect. And in what form is the cause there? Because Krishna is Sarva Karana Karanam, the cause of all causes, in his most beautiful two-armed forms, playing his flute in his dark complexion. So, thus it is explained that a state of always being united with Krishna through love is the highest secret. But is herein explained only indirect and in an obscure manner. Similarly, in the manner of the Brahmajnana is indirectly explained by the device of describing something else. So what Siva Goswami says, yes, this verse is also satisfying the Brahmajnana, the Brahmavadis and so on. They think, yes, this is real knowledge, that the cause is in the effect, but they don't understand the inner meaning, which is explained here by Shiva Goswami. In Anuchit 158-159, Shiva Goswami discusses that even in the Prakrat Lila, after his departure from Vraj, the gopis remain in contact with Krishna in their minds. In Anuchet 161 and 164, he continues the discussion. Sri Krishna expects the following argument from the gopis. Instead of considering us to be greatly affected in separation from you, due to your compassion at heart, teaching us how to attain you, why are you not personally coming in such a way? Why teach us this complicated knowledge? Just come, the gopi says. Out of your so-called compassion, you are teaching us and giving us these messages. We consider your compassion simply cheating. So, of course, these gopis, they are eternal associates of Krishna. They have only pure spiritual consciousness. That they don't need this jnana that Krishna is everywhere. That we need that in this world. That, but they are always connected with Krishna. That they have never been separated, really. We consider your compassion simply cheating. Considering that the gopis might think like this, Lord Krishna speaks the following words in verse 34. My dear gopis, although you are accustomed to love me from the beginning of your lives, to increase your super excellent love for me, I have purposely separated myself from you. So that's the explanation Krishna gives them. That it was just to increase your love. I have done this so that you can meditate on me constantly. In this verse, Lord Krishna says to the gopis, although you are full of love for me and always eager to see me, I have now separated myself from your company in order that you may constantly meditate on me. In this way, you may always see me in your mind, just as you formerly saw me with your eyes. Lord Krishna continues with his explanation in the next verse, 10:47-35. I will read 10:47-35 just so that we can understand this comment deeply. 35, when her lover is far away, a woman thinks of him more than he is present before him. So when a woman's beloved is far away, she thinks of him meditatively, and she's actually more conscious of him than when he's actually present. In the same way, you have become more conscious of me in your condition of separation than I was directly present before you. And then the next verse, 36, because your minds are totally absorbed in me and free from all other engagements, you remember me always, that, and you will very soon have me again in your presence. That is 36. So, my dear gopis, because you you think constantly of me without thinking of something else. So the thinking of Krishna never ceases. It is like pouring honey from a spoon. It is a continuous stream of svarasakir realization. A continuous stream of Krishna manifesting his pastimes. Of course, you constantly think of me and nothing else, because you never forget me. You will quickly attain me. Now, in Anuchet 164, Shiva Goswami quotes 10:47 37. I read the verse. Although some gopis had to remain in the coward village, and so could not join the rasa dance to sport with me at night in the forest, they were not less fortunate. Indeed, they attained me by thinking of my potent pastimes. So Chief Goswami quotes this verse, and also verse 44. And then he paraphrases the essence of these two verses. 44. Build up the sons of Dasara. Dasara, return here, and by the touch of his limbs bring back to life those who are now burning with the grief he himself has caused. Will he save us in that way? Just as Lord Indra brings a forest back to life with his watering, bearing clouds. So, then of these two verses, he paraphrases the essence. The verses are quite similar. I am completely submissive to the pure love of my devotees, and thus every day I leave the city of the Yadus and come to Brajbhumi, continually revealing my form to the residents there. I do this due to my repeated promise to return to Vrindavan. So that's how Krishna explains. I came back and was always there. Every day. Anucheta 165 continues. The gopis were able to understand the description of Krishna's apricot presence, and they were satisfied that they were actually not separated from him. So, at the end, hearing Uddhava's message, the gopis were satisfied, and this is the reason. I can give it again. Read it again. So, what Shiva Goswami writes in Anucheta 165. The gopis were able to understand the description of Krishna's apricot presence, and they were satisfied that they were actually not separated from him. Sukadev Goswami describes their satisfaction in Srimad Bhagavatam in verse 38. That's the proof. The women of Raj were pleased to hear this message from their dearmost Krishna. His words having revived their memory, they addressed Uddhava as follows. So that describes their satisfaction. So they were pleased to hear the message of Lord Krishna, to show that they understood that they were not actually separated from him. Shiva Goswami adds, remembering Lord Krishna's instructions, the gopis were able to directly see Lord Krishna's apricot form and pastimes, and they became relieved from their strong feelings of separation, and they became very pleased. Shiva Goswami said that the gopis be pleased because Krishna said before that because you are always thinking of me, I will very soon be in your presence. So the gopis were always absorbed in thinking of Krishna, and therefore they were pleased to have Krishna soon again in their presence. That is what they truly wanted. They just wanted the presence of Krishna. They didn't care for anything else at all. Now, we will hear what the gopis said in reply to Uddhava's message. We heard it already yesterday, but I'm going again to the verses. Then we will speak how Uddhava replied to the experience of the gopis, and that's the last part. But first, I read again from text 39 till 52 is prayer to Krishna. 39. The gopis said, it's very good that Kamsa, the enemy and persecutor of the Yadus, has now been killed along with his followers. And it is also very good that Lord Asyuta is living happily in the company of his well-wishing friends and relatives, whose every desire is now fulfilled. Gentle Uddhava is the elder brother of Gada, now bestowing on the city women the pleasure that actually belongs to us. We suppose Those ladies worship him with generous glances full of affectionate smiles. Sri Krishna is expert of all kinds of conjugal affairs and is the darling of the city women. How can he not become entangled now that he is constantly adored with their enchanting words and gestures? O saintly one, does Govinda even remember us during his conversations with the city women? Does he ever mention us village girls as he freely talks with them? Does he recall those nights in the Vrindavan forest, lovely with lotus, jasmine and the bright moon? As we glorified his charming pastimes, he enjoyed with us his beloved girlfriends in the circle of the rasa dance, which resounded with the music of anchor bells. Will the descendant of Dasara return here, and by the touch of his limbs bring back to life those who are burning with the grief he has caused himself? Will he save us in that way, just as Lord Indra brings a forest back to life with his water-bearing clouds? But why should Krishna come here after winning a kingdom, his enemies and marrying the killing his enemies and marrying the daughters of kings? He's satisfied there, surrounded by all his friends and well-wishers. The great soul Krishna is a lord of the gods of fortune, and he automatically achieves whatever he desires. How can we forest dwellers or any woman fulfill his purpose when he's already fulfilled with himself? Indeed, the greatest happiness is to renounce all desires, as even the prostitute Pingala has declared. Yet, even though we know this, we cannot give our hopes of attaining Krishna. We can bear to give up intimate talks with Uttama Sloka. Although he shows no interest in our goddess, she never moves from her place on his chest. Dear Uddhav, when Krishna was there in the company of Sankarsana, he enjoyed all these rivers, hills, forests, cows and flutes. All these remind us constantly of Nanda's son. Indeed, because we see Krishna's footprints, which are marked with the divine symbols, we can never forget. O Uddhav, how can we forget him when our hearts have been stolen away by the charming way he walks? His general smile and playful glances and his honey-like words, and then text 52, that's factually a prayer to Lord Krishna of the gopis. And they pray, O master of the goddess of fortune, master of virtue, destroyer of all suffering, Govinda, please lift your Gokul out of the ocean of distress in which it is drowning. Then text 53. Sukadev continued, Lord Krishna's message having relieved their fever of separation, the gopis then worshipped Uddhav, recognizing him as non-different from their Lord Krishna. So this is this last verse is a summary of or the result of the gopis hearing. Krishna's message that received through his messenger Uddhav, it relieved them from their fever of separation, and they worshipped Uddhav, recognizing him as non-different from their Lord Krishna. So, I have a look at 53. There is a small purport. Srila Sridhar Swami states that the word Janatvanam, Adoksyam, also indicate that the gopis recognize Krishna to be the very soul of their lives and thus spiritually one with them. So what gives life to the soul? That it is Krishna, the gopis say. The love of the Vrajavasis was so powerful, unlimitedly powerful, even when they came in contact consciously with the realization that he is indeed a powerful Lord, still their love for him did not the minus in the least, not in any way. And anything that happened, it could not diminish, nor could it increase. It was already on the topmost level. Now we will read from verse 50-58, and read the purports also of Śrīla Viśvanātha Caravakti Thakur. So 54. One minute, here on my screen, 54. A very long purpose. Uddhav remained there for several months, dispelling the gopis' sorrow by chanting the topics of Lord Krishna's pastimes. Thus he brought joy to all the people of Gokul. That, so, the great Acharya Jiva Goswami comments in this regard that Uddhav, during his stay in Vrindavan, especially took special care to enliven Krishna's foster parents. Now, there's a commentary of Śrīla Viśvanātha Caravakti Thakur on this verse 54. It's a long comment, but it's an important one. We will read it. That, yes, till verse 54. When out of sorrow the gopis hoped for Krishna's return through them, and they became eager to give up their lives, Uddhav made them happy by speaking yet other messages, even more confidential. That is the significance of the word after that. Thus, Sukadev Goswami has not explicitly described those messages. One can understand them by the result they had on the gopis. Krishna said, "O you who are as dear to me as life, why you are standing before my messenger Uddhav, just close your eyes. Just as the coward boys closed their eyes and were delivered from the forest fire, close your eyes and I will deliver you from the devastating fire of separation. Witness my mystic power." Interesting. Hearing this, the gopis closed their eyes. In a flash of a second, Yuga Maya compressed millions of years of time in a single moment. Krishna then appeared on that spot, and in the company of the gopis enjoyed the rasa dance in the Vrindavan forest, playing dice, drinking honey, liquor, water sporting, and swings, pastimes. By enjoying all these pastimes, the gopis forgot all their pains of separation. Seeing that all their limbs were exuberant in ecstasy, Uddhav paused for a moment and said, "Now, ladies, open your eyes again." Upon opening their eyes, the gopis felt that they had taken a new birth through the bestowal of a thousandfold bliss, and when they had closed eyes, recognizing Uddhav was none different from Krishna Adoksya, then they worshipped Uddhav. The syllable Ado in the word Adoksya means downward, Aksha means eyes, and Cha means birth. Krishna said, "O women filled with prema, if you give up your lives, I will also give up my life upon hearing this news. Don't doubt it. Swearing 1,000 times, I declare, you are my very life. Even though I'm trying to go to Vraj at every moment, I'm unable to do. Perhaps I'm being kept here because of the time of the endeavor is not right. And else because of the love the Mathura Vasas have for me is an obstacle." By such messages, the gopis' fever of separation caused by their thinking that Krishna had no love for them was completely dispelled. Thinking that Adoksya, Krishna, was afflicted by the pain of separation like themselves, Atmanama Patulyam, whilst thinking that Krishna was their life, the gopis then worshipped Uddhav. The gopis said to Uddhav, "We have spoken well. Even at the cost of suffering the greatest pain, we will remain alive. If you had not given this message, we would have certainly died, and everything would have been destroyed. Therefore, by saving us, you have fulfilled our desire to protect everyone involved, and thus we worship you. The external meaning that the gopis recognize their own soul as one with the transcendental Lord, the supersoul, is simply a meaning to bewilder the asuras. This is not the real meaning. Indeed, this scriptural passage is just like Mohini incarnation in its effect. From the Prema Bhakti oneness of the Lord, the Jiva is insipid. What to speak then, how repulsive it would be for the gopis, for the caste jewel of all unalloyed devotees, that with the caste jewel of all unalloyed devotees, to think such a thing. Indeed, Sridhar Swami, who knows best the purpose of the advanced scriptures, has stated, any person who has become mad with bliss by sporting in the nectarian ocean of topics of Krishna thinks of the four goals of human life as insignificant as a blade of life, a blade of grass. It's quite a long purpose, but it's an important one. The next purposes are not so long as this one. But, it can be seen that even the most potent knowledge of the soul can never cover one who has fully developed Krishna prema. When Vasudev and Arjun saw the Mahasvarya aspect of Krishna, their parental and friendly relationship became covered by Dasya Bhakti, but not by Brahma Jnan, knowledge of Brahman. It has seen that the Vajravas were merged in Brahma Jnan, but this was only to show their distaste for knowledge of Brahman. Krishna brought the Vajravas to the lake of Brahman, merged them into it, and then brought them out. Tetu Brahma Ridam Nita Machna Krishnena Chodrita, 10.28.16. The word Udrita, brought them out or delivered them, is especially used in the text. Just as living entities are delivered from the ocean of samsara, the inhabitants of Vraj were delivered from the repulsive Brahman. Furthermore, the gopis had developed monistic atmajnan, realization of the soul as one with Brahman. That they would not have spoken to Balaram with such unsettled minds as they did, he later returned to Vraj. Sukadev Goswami said, honored to have the personal audience of Lord Balaram, the young gopi smiled and asked, is Krishna the darling of the city women, living happily? One gopi said, it is astonishing that the intelligent women of Mathura have faith in the words of the ungrateful, fickle-hearted Krishna. Another gopi said, they must have developed faith in his words because he speaks so wonderfully, and also his beautiful smiling glances arouse their lust. Indeed, if the Vrachagopis had attained the states of Brahma Jnan, they could never speak as they are going into the future, such jealous words as quoted before, indicative of their ignorance of the soul of Brahman. That is quite deep purport. Text 55. Text 65. That all the days that Uddhav dwelt in Nanda's coward village seemed like a single moment to the residents of Vraj, for Uddhav was always discussing Krishna. So it's wonderful how time acts on the spiritual platform. That how did time pass in a moment? Krishna Prayani, in Uddhav's presence. The name Uddhav means extreme bliss. Besides, Krishna had also empowered Uddhav with the capacity to bestow bliss on others. Thus time passed in a moment for the Vrajavasis, who felt extreme happiness in association of Uddhav, bliss personified. Text 56. That servant of Lord Hari, seeing the rivers, forests, mountains, valleys and flowering trees of Vraj, enjoyed inspiring the inhabitants of Vraj by reminding them of Lord Krishna. Thus, seeing how the gopis were always disturbed because of their total absorption in Krishna, Uddhav was supremely pleased desiring to offer them all respects, is sung as follows. Having obtained the transcendental, this Vishvanatha Saraswati Thakur, having obtained the transcendental madness, Viklavam, of the gopis who attained the high state of loving ecstasy wherein their minds were always absorbed in Krishna, and having seen their other exalted qualities, Uddhava loudly sang prayers offering all respect to them. According to Sridhar Swami, Uddhava spoke loudly to show that it was not improper for one of the of Kshatriya birth to pay obeisance to mere coward girls. Text 59, 58. Uddhava sang, among all persons on earth, these coward women alone have actually perfected their embodied lives, for they have achieved the perfection of unalloyed love for Krishna, for Lord Govinda. Here it starts with Uddhava sang, Uddhava Gita, that this verse. So from here, 58 till the 63, that these are six verses spoken by Uddhava. We will go over these verses again, but I will first read all these verses. But first for 58 in the purport. Among all persons on earth, these coward women alone have actually perfected their embodied lives, for they have achieved the perfection of unalloyed love for Lord Govinda. Their pure love is hankered after by those who fear material existence, by great sages and by ourselves as well. For one who has tasted the narrations of the infinite Lord, what is the use of taking birth as a high-class Brahman or even as Brahma himself? So Vishvanatha Saraswati Thakur said, Uddhava describes the outstanding glories of the Vraja Gopis in five verses, from 58 till 62. Uddhava sang, the Gopis alone have perfected their lives by achieving Rudra Bhava. Which those striving for liberation, those who are liberated and devotees such as I desire but cannot attain. So they were on the platform of Rudra Bhava. Therefore, for one who has attraction to the topics of the unlimited Lord, what is the use of brahminical birth? The threefold births by seminal parenthood, the sacred thread initiation, and the sacrificial initiation which pertain to Brahmins. There is nothing special about them, since just by attraction to the topics of the unlimited, one can attain highest achievement, or else, for one who is not attracted to the topics of the unlimited, what's the value of brahminical births? Since lack of attraction to these topics renders all such births useless. Now I will read all the verses up to 63 from Uddhava. How amazing it that these simple women who wander about the forest seemingly spoiled by improper behavior have achieved the perfection of unalloyed love for Krishna, the Supreme Soul. Still, it is true that the Supreme Lord himself awards his blessings even to ignorant worshipper, just as the best medicine, even when taken by a person ignorant of its ingredients. When Lord Krishna was dancing with the gopis in the Rasa Lila, the gopis were embraced by the arms of the Lord. This transcendental favor was never bestowed upon the goddess of fortune or other consorts in the spiritual world. Indeed, there was Nevertheless, there is such a thing even imagined by the most beautiful girls in heavenly planets, whose bodily luster and aroma resemble the lotus flower. And what to speak of worldly women who are very beautiful according to material estimation. The Gopis of Vrindavan have given up their association of their husbands, sons and other family members, who are very difficult to give up, and they have forsaken the path of chastity to take shelter of the lotus feet of Mukunda. Krishna, which one should search for by Vedic knowledge. Oh, let me be fortunate enough to be one of the bushes, capers or herbs in Vrindavan, because the gopis trample them and bless them with the dust of their lotus feet. The cause of fortune herself, along with Lord Brahma and all other demigods, who are masters of yogic perfection, can worship the lotus feet of Krishna only within their mind. But during the rasa dance, Lord Krishna placed his feet upon this gopis' breast and embraced them, those gopis, by giving up all distress. I repeatedly offer my respects to the dust from the lotus feet of the women of Nanda Maharaj, Kaur's village. When these gopis loudly chant the glories of Sri Krishna, the vibration purifies the three worlds. So this is the words of spoken by Uddhav. So we will go over these verses again, some parts of it. That, so we were starting with verse 58 we read already this purport. Rudabhav, that is the topmost achievement, Rudabhav, the most ecstatic love for Krishna. That so Ruda means advanced, Aniruddha means highly advanced. They are both available to the gopis. A definition of this is given by Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami in Utsva, and this definition is given in Utsvala Nilamani. It said there, the very sweet attraction of conjugal love increases to affection, counter love, love, attachment, sub-attachment, ecstasy, and highly advanced ecstasy. So these are all the stages to affection, sneha, the first level of prema. Counter-love is pranaya, love, mana, attachment, raga, anuraga, sub-attachment. Then bhava, ecstasy, and highly advanced ecstasy is mabhav. So the platform of mabhav includes ruda and aniruda. So the platform are only possible in conjugal love, only in conjugal love, this platform. The highest ecstasy is found among the gopis. So having tasted having a taste of Krishna Katha guarantees our perfection. Preaching is a transference of taste. As long as one taste remains in the material world, one will wander in the material world. So that is, text 59 now, before we read the purport of Vishvanathaswami Thakur, there is a purport of Srila Sridhar Swami, 59. It is the mode of their worship that is great. The highest type of worship is the worship of the Vraja Gopikas. It is full love, giving body, mind and everything. They are topmost ragatmika. So that is text 59. That Srila Vishvanathaswami Thakur on 59. So, therefore, the reason for someone being most exalted is devotion only, and not such factors as performance of austerities and knowledge. Through this devotion, the most exalted, it is not deemed so by the common people. Remaining in such a place, pure devotion makes one its own shelter, making him most exalted, worshipable by all, and most reproachable, and most rarely approachable. In two verses, Uddhav speaks about his astonishment, his hair standing on end while he's speaking this. Uddhav sang, "These gopis are considered lowly on account of their being women, their birth as cowards, and their behavior. Since it is their nature to wander about the forest, they are naturally contaminated by improper behavior. So where have these women attained Mahabhav, Uddhabhav? For Krishna, the Supreme Soul, who is the source of all other souls and superior, paramount to all these other forms as the Lord of Vaikuntha." The use of the word qua, where, in the first two lines indicates the impossibility of its existence. In other words, where else have such persons as these apparently insignificant and impure gopis attained the highest perfection of life, namely unalloyed pure love for Krishna? It seems most astonishing that they could be so spiritually elevated. But on thinking a moment, Uddhav decided, "Is this not amazing?" Uddhav continued thinking, "Certainly the Supreme Lord can give this most auspicious thing to such persons as this, who are without philosophical knowledge of Atma and Brahman, and not just to perfected persons. To devotees like the gopis, Krishna gave liberation from samsara and the pure ecstatic taste of his love, which is difficult to attain even for liberated souls. Nectar, the king of medicines, gives substantial benefits by bestowing a unique sweet taste along with dispelling a person's disease, even to the ignorant of his identity. Similarly, why then should Krishna not give that most exalted Mahabhav, which even the devotees like Narada cannot attain, to these gopis who are perfect in devotion and eternally liberated? Besides that, these gopis are in full knowledge of Krishna's personal form and identity, qualities, opulence and sweetness. They are engaged in their intelligence in Krishna's service, as well as their limbs of their bodies, their youth, feminine charms, and all their ornaments." Now, this text 6 now, and it shows the example of the Bratsha Gopika's great fortune. I read the verse again. "When Lord Sri Krishna was dancing with the gopis in the Rasa Lila, the gopis were embraced by the arms of the Lord. The transcendental favor was never bestowed to the goddess of fortune or other consorts in the spiritual world. Indeed, never was there such a thing even imagined by the beautiful girls in the heavenly planets, whose body lustre and aroma resemble the lotus flower. And what to speak of worldly women who are beautiful according to material estimation." Commentary by Vishvanathasarvati Thakur. "Sri Krishna, the best of all avatars, exists on the highest platform of purity and morality, and thus he always remains praiseworthy by all, even while accepting worldly criticism of his cow tending, wandering in the forest, taking meals with young monkeys, stealing yogurt, and seducing other men's wives. Similarly, the gopis, who are the essence of Krishna's pleasure potency, achieved the highest standard of purity and auspiciousness, even in comparison to the goddess of fortune. And thus the gopis are supremely glorious, even though they were criticized by worldly people, because they were mere coward women living in the forest and behaving in an apparent improper way. Uddhav said, 'Oh, even Lakshmi, who resides upon the chest of Lord Narayan, who has enjoyed unlimitedly with them, never got such mercy.'" Text 61 explains here in 61, Buddha explains the nature of their worship. I read the verse again. The gopis of Vrindavan have given up the association of their husbands, sons, and other family members, while very difficult to give up. And they have forsaken the path of chastity to take shelter of the feet of Mukunda, Krishna, which one should search for by Vedic knowledge. Oh, let me be fortunate even to be one of the bushes, creepers, and herbs in Vrindavan, because the gopis trample them and bless them with the dust of their lotus feet. So, this is a verse, and I would say key verse, which is quoted many times in relation to Uddhava and his experience with the gopis. We read the commentary of this. Uddhava said, as it has been proven that the gopis' love is the most rare to attain, it would be improper to desire it. Therefore, it was with lack of judgment that I said that Mahabhav, which those desiring liberation, the liberated and devotees like me hanker after. But now with proper consideration, let me correctly express my desire. I want to be born as some low shrub, creeper or grass upon which the gopis will place their feet. One may question, but what is that supreme excellence of the gopis worship that you desire their food dust rather than that of such exalted personalities as Lakshmi? Buddha replied, I never seen such intense worship where one can break all the mundane principles of religiosity, shyness and sense control. Every night the Vraja gopis give up all shame, their respectable upbringing and religious codes which are hard as thunderbolts to break and run off to meet Krishna. At the time of returning home, they are completely oblivious as to whether they are following the right footpath or not. Then they will place their blessed feet upon my head, which will be present there in the form of some blade of grass. As for now, even though I pitifully beg for it millions of times, they are not willing to put their feet on my head. Therefore, my life will be successful only if I'm born as a blade of grass. 62. The gods of fortune herself, along with Lord Brahma and all the other demigods who are masters of yogic perfection, can worship the lotus feet of Krishna only within her mind. But during the Rasa dance, Lord Krishna placed his feet upon his gopis' breast and embraced those feet. The gopis gave up all the distress. So in this verse, Uddhava again glorifies the Mahabhav of the gopis, which is inaccessible to Lakshmi and others. Uddhava said, indeed, the gopis relieved their mental anguish at the Rasa arena by embracing the lotus feet of Krishna to their breast. These are the same lotus feet that Brahma, Lakshmi and others worship in their minds, but can never touch directly. This point is explained in such verses as Yat Vankaya Shri Lala Nasara Tapo Vyayo Kamansu Chiram Dritavrata. Designed to touch your lotus feet, the goddess of fortune performed austerities for centuries, giving up all other desires and taking austere vows. So 63 is the last words of Buddha before he leaves. I repeatedly offer my respects to the dust from the feet of the women of Nanda Maharaj's covered village. When these gopis loudly chant the glories of Sri Krishna, the vibration purifies the three worlds. So after glorifying the gopis, Uddhava offers his respects in this verse. Uddhava said, I offer my respect to the dust of the covered women of Raj continuously, as long as I do not get birth as a blade of grass, which will make it easy to get their food dust. Their loud songs about the form, qualities, pastimes of Krishna purify the three worlds, removing the contamination of ignorance. In the phrase Padarenam Abhiksnasa, the affix sa indicates perpetually, not just three or five times a day. So we will to finish it. Remaining verses. Sukadev Goswami said, Uddhav, descendant of Dasara, took the permission to leave from the gopis and from Mother Yasoda in Nanda Maharaj. He bade farewell to all the coward men about to depart, mounted his chariot. As Uddhav was about to leave, Nanda and the others approached him, bearing various items of worship. With tears in their eyes, they addressed him as follows. Nanda Maharaj in the coward said, may our mental functions always take shelter of Krishna's lotus feet. May our words always chant his names, and may our bodies always bow down to him and serve him. Wherever we are made to wander about this world by the Supreme Lord's will, in according with the reactions of our fruitive activities, may our good words and charity always grant us love for Krishna. So, Srila, this is interesting that Nanda Maharaj is praying for this, but Srila Vishvanatha Bhakti Thakur explains in the purport. Nanda Maharaj said, our dear long-lived Uddhav, we Krishna's mother and father have been most hard-hearted toward our son, even though he is a great ocean of beauty, good qualities and character. And we remain so even now. We understand that the abundant affection and care we previously showed for Krishna now appear to have been artificial, since even in his absence we remain alive. So he said, we are remain alive, that therefore it shows we have no love. King Dasara was actually the only real father in this world, because he immediately died upon hearing that his son Ram had gone away. We, on the other hand, do not have even a trace of love for our son Krishna. Therefore, this omniscient son of ours has rejected us as unqualified parents, being the Supreme Personality of God, that he has used his inconceivable ingenuity to make Devaki and Vyasadeva his parents instead. Therefore, Yasadeva, Yasoda and I should be completely condemned as the most unfortunate person in the three worlds. Nevertheless, perhaps in some future lifetime we may become aware of Krishna and as he is and become attracted to him. So in this way, Nanda Maharaj prays in two verses that the Nanda Maharaj statement, may our minds take shelter of Krishna's feet, is a reversal due to great love. Actually, the mind and senses and of Nanda and Yasoda were always absorbed in Krishna, but they prayed in this way. This indicates the extreme predominance of Chansari Bhav and Danya, or humility within them. And then more details are given on that. Text 6 to 8, Sukadev Goswami continued, O ruler of man, thus honored by the coward man with expressions of devotion, followed Krishna. Uddhav went back to the city of Mathura, which was under Krishna's protection. In the last verse, after falling down to pay his homage, Uddhav described to Lord Krishna the immense devotion of the residents of Raj. Uddhav also described it to Vasudeva, Lord Balaram, King Ungrasena, and presented to them the gifts of tribute he had brought with him. Srila Vishvanatha Chakravarti Thakur comments, Uddhav describes how the inhabitants of Raj had unlimited more devotion than the residents of Mathura. Uddhav said, my dear Master Krishna, all the scriptures conclude that you are controlled by pure devotion, attained by devotion and seen only by devotion. Now I have directly seen that among all your devotees, the Vrajavasis have the most intense devotion. After all, your father Nanda has said, O Krishna, everyone in Gokul has turned white in separation from you. This has even fooled the great sage among the demigods Narada to mistake Gokul for Svetadvipa. Uddhav continued, Krishna, your father Nanda Maharaj was so bewildered in your absence that he prayed that his mind would concentrate on you. From this, you can understand his overwhelming attraction to you. And your mother Yasoda was so choked up that she could not say anything. Hearing this, Krishna lost control of his mind and senses and cried loudly in the midst of public assembly. That night, in a secluded place, Uddhav revealed to Krishna the blazing Tertiarian fire of the gopis' love for him. After it, I've related to Krishna just one day of the divine madness of Shirada, the crown jewel of his dear gopis and her wonderful prattling Chitat Jalpa, Krishna stayed up the whole night burning with fever in separation from Radhika. But that's the end of this chapter, that it has been a whole journey in the consciousness of the Bhaja Gopis. So, what did you learn? What did you appreciate in this chapter? What inspired you in this chapter? Please share.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. As we've been going through these chapters, I've been thinking a lot about how, the way that Uddhava pacified the gopis, mm-hmm. that they can be present with Krishna by, you know, intense remembrance of him, thinking about him and all that. I was thinking that that's also a relevant instruction for us, you know, that Krishna's very far away, but by being conscious of him, by really being present when we chant the holy names and hearing Srimad Bhagavatam, we can actually have an experience of Krishna that can make us feel Krishna's presence more. And then, you know, those instances where we feel Krishna's presence, it starts to expand into all the different parts of our lives. And then we can actually become Krishna conscious and, you know, be with Krishna in that bhava expansion way to, you know, tiny little extent.
Yeah, these are our aspirations. Thank you. Thank you for sharing this. That Madhakasturi Kampi.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, first of all, a big thank you for you, because you studied so elaborately and he explained to us. It was such a treasure. The other day I was thinking how this separation, love separation in the material world, it's actually very devastating to the people. Some people even take their lives. But I was just thinking, on the other hand, how spiritual world is so personal, that every trait of that feelings are present in the material world, but in such a perverted way. And I was thinking on that point, and how, what a gift is that Prabhupada made it to such a personal moment. And I was also thinking, like, how I should be praying for more humility, because I'm not there yet to be absolute, but I was thinking I should be praying for humility to go deeper in this consciousness. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That's a very nice observation. That anything others to share? That yes, Pavitra.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, thank you Maharaj for the wonderful explanations, giving us depth of this chapter. Maharaj, the title of the chapter is The Song of the Bee. And all the verses, I didn't see any song of the bee, Maharaj.
Yes, the song of the bee was imagined by Srimati Radharani. That and our commentators sometimes have voiced the words spoken by the bee, which Srimati Radharani imagined. that's interesting. The song of the bee, It can also refer to the mad talks of Srimad Radharani. That's also the song of the bee, because he sings about the bee. That I think it's more likely to have that meaning. That if you're mad, and all the chitra jalpa, so many kinds of jalpa, that I remember in the Bhaktivedanta exam that I took, and one of the questions is to mention three or four of these jalpas and explain it. That it's good to study them, and you know something about these mad talks. But to understand the deeper meaning, we need love for Krishna. So that's very interesting. I feel for my part it is way above what I can understand. I'm still trying to realize that I'm not this body. Fully realizing that and yes, I feel some satisfaction in my service, but this great ecstasy, but it gives a glimpse. I remember this is 25 years ago. I was chanting in Mayapur. I was CBC secretary there. I was studying also at the Mayapur Institute. MEHG at that time. And one morning my chanting became very ecstatic. I never got it after that. But I'd experienced during that chanting that time was different. It went so quick. But it was a feeling of devotion I could feel. It gives me a glimpse to what we can expect when we get to the higher stages. But it's not our goal to aspire for that. Our goal is to serve Krishna. And whatever Krishna gives us, that's all right. That gives satisfaction and some peace to the heart.
Hare Krishna.
Other comments, please.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Maharaj. I just want to thank you for taking this section with us. It was really ecstatic, and the amount of preparation you have done for this section, you can see how you have read all the commentaries and how you've read the sandarbhas and how you took out everything for us. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you also for sending this chapter about Sri Dham cursing Radharani. I read it yesterday. But that's going on in Goloka Vrindavan. Goloka Vrindavan. But it's interesting. Krishna prepares for his pastimes on this earth, and then Yoga Maya arranges for things to happen in Goloka Vrindavan. It's very interesting to read that. That's astonishing. Murli Darsyam Prabhu, yes?
Hare Krishna Maharaj, thank you for your wonderful class, Maharaj. It's really nice and active, Maharaj. Maharaj, during the Prakat and Apakrat Leela that you are describing, it make me to meditate on Sisastaka. Please correct if I'm wrong. All the gopis bhava that been exhibited, that we all the while we discuss, is a kind of a ascent in the Sisastaka is written by Mahaprabhu.
Yeah.
This how I can meditate. You can do like a 12 years boy, you can make me cry and all these things. So
yeah, especially the last verse hints to the Mahabhava of the gopis. Aslisya Vapadamritastimam. That is this last verse, wherein Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, yeah, whether you tremble me or break my heart by not being present of me, in that way. Because Lord Chaitanya is in the mood of Srimad Radharani. But it outlines also the six oskam, the path to attain this level. Very good point. Thank you, Muralidhar Srinivasa.
Maharaj, so since we're meditating in this Sastaka and also we sing this this pastime of the gopis dealing with Krishna, how we as a sadhaka sometimes we feel difficult whenever we have joy, only we thinking of Krishna. When we are happiness, we forget about him. So how we can, as a normal sadhaka, so how we want to take in our life is very serious, because until the deep realization that Maharaj sharing is like really is a nectar, that it connected me to this Sastaka and meditate on that. So how should I take in my daily life, Maharaj? Can you give some advice and tips to take heart and soul on this, Maharaj?
Well, if you want to take my advice, I can only share my experience. And it's a process and it takes some time. And we have to learn first, whatever good or bad happens in our lives is Krishna's mercy. Unless we have learned that, we cannot go further. And sometimes it's hard to learn. Krishna brings you in situations where you have to give up your attachment. And if you don't, you will continue suffering. Then we have to learn that. But once we come to it, then we can, by Krishna's mercy, develop this deeper attachment to Krishna and love. So it's a process. Then it takes some time. It's the drama of life we have to go through. And once you become a devotee, Krishna takes charge of it. And you have to learn what you have to learn. Even if Uddhav has to learn on a higher level. So we have to learn all these things. But this chapter gives us a glimpse. You speak about the eighth verse of Sikshastika. What does it mean? Now we know something after hearing these chapters, what it means. But before, what does it mean? But now we heard about the separation of the gopis, the Mahabharata. Is that all?
Yes, Maharaj. Thank you so much, Maharaj.
Hare Krishna. So, bye. Well, Shyaman Shoti Krishna Prabhu, please speak.
So, Hare Krishna, Maharaj, Dandavat Pranam. So, on behalf of BIG, we would like to thank you for this wonderful seva and for giving. Helping us repeatedly.
Prajanan Prabhu, there are a few more devotees wanting to speak still.
Yes, Mother.
So we will wait for them to finish. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you so much.
Okay. Shyam Shoti Krishna Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, you mentioned a breakdown of the word adoksha earlier. Could you possibly break it down again or remind us how or what it actually means?
I forget to break down. It was broken down in the commentaries. But adoksha means beyond the perception of the material senses. That's adoksha. Not perceivable by our senses, material senses. But we see that the gopis perceiving on the spiritual platform that we have to be on the spiritual platform to perceive Krishna. Krishna consciousness is the process, Srila Prabhupada said, to see, to come face to face, to see Krishna face to face. But we cannot see with our eyes that that it's mentioned also in the Bhaktiya Samhita Sindhu. Natasi Krishna Namadina Bhavit Chaimindra Gichivatis Fayam Eva Spratyata. So we cannot appreciate Krishna's form qualities, pastimes with our material senses. But when we use our tongue to chant Krishna's holy names, to taste only prasad, and we become purified, and then we become to know who Krishna really is. So that's the process of coming to know who Krishna really is. That, yes, then, because we have this body, these are our material senses. That's a gross body. Beneath we have a subtle body. And beneath the subtle body is the spiritual body, which is now becoming active. That, and the idea is that our spiritual body becomes active again. But it becomes active when we are purified. And then we see Krishna all the time, if our senses and mind are completely purified. We see Krishna all the time. Srila Prabhupada, someone asked Srila Prabhupada, did you see Krishna? And Srila Prabhupada said, I'm seeing him all the time. So that's the pure devotee. But we are not on that platform yet. Our false ego is in between. False ego means that the subtle and the gross body are still active. That's created by the false ego. Does that help, Shyamanjyoti Krishna?
Yes. The other examples you gave earlier today, in today's class, cowherd boys, they were asked to close their eyes, when Krishna swallowed the fire. So that was quite a good example. And then similar with gopis, they close their eyes, they can absorb themselves in Krishna. So it's a good way of meditating sometimes when you close our eyes.
It requires faith, and closer eyes means that go inwards, forget about external world and see only Krishna. That's a deep meditation. For that you need devotion to Krishna.
Also, example of Maharaj, Dhruva Maharaj, when he was meditating on Krishna inside, then once the meditation stopped, he was wondering what happened to Krishna, and then Krishna actually physically comes in front of him, in his eyes, in front of him.
That's interesting. So that's something we learned in this chapter also, that the gopis, it's by their feelings of separation, they could feel Krishna always in their heart. And that's a more intense love than seeing him externally. So cultivating that feeling of separation will make us feel Krishna inside. That always searching for Krishna. Those are the six good Brahmins. Thank you.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Hare Krishna. Mother Prabhupada Priya, please.
Hare Krishna. I was wondering if now that Krishna's Prakat Leela is not there, in Vrindavan, is the Aprakat Leela still going on?
Aprakat Leela is always going on. Never stops, even today.
Is that only in the geographical area of Raj, or is it anywhere that devotees are in pure Krishna consciousness, they can access it?
Anywhere where the devotees are, they can access it. There's no limit to that. That's therefore say that where Prabhupada was Vrindavan. He was always connected with him. How could he see Krishna every moment? Everywhere he was. So that's tight connection with Krishna.
Is it just so, and the way to access that is through feelings of separation?
Well, it is, you must have feelings of separation, an intense love for Krishna. You need intense love for Krishna. Where does intense love for Krishna coming from? From the feelings of separation. But it is intense love for Krishna. It comes from these feelings of separation. Yes. That's what we are trying to cultivate. That by the feelings of deep feelings of separation, we are factually with Krishna. That's what explained this. That's overall theme in this chapter. The message of Krishna: I am not separated from you. We are separated by our consciousness. We have removed Krishna from our consciousness. That's the three modes of nature. But we have to connect again with Krishna. Mamsi of Yabhicharana Bhakti Runa Sivita Sakatan Samatichuta and Brahma Bhuya Kalpati. By unalloyed devotional service we transcend these modes immediately. And unalloyed devotional service means love for Krishna. Love for Krishna. Without this love, we cannot transcend. Without this love, we cannot feel happy in this world.
Hearing these pastimes of Krishna in the 10th canto like this has been very nice for, you know, helping to bring out the attraction for Krishna, hearing all the interactions and all the intensity of the devotee's love for Krishna sort of fuels the desire to at least this type of attraction.
It gives us accents to a certain extent to Krishna's, to the spiritual world, to the consciousness of this eternal associate. And that's very inspiring. Whatever we have understood, the very little we have understood. Right. Good. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Maharaj, for all your explanations and all the hard work you put into preparing our classes and always being here on time and present with us.
Yeah.
So,
I'm trying my best. With all your blessings, I may continue because I start traveling now again. I start traveling Canada, Bulgaria, Germany, and then hopefully to New York again. And then India will open, so I will go to Ujjain. Let's see.
Maharaj, you should come down and see us here in Gainesville, Florida.
I've been invited there. That been there before in Gainesville, but many years ago. I like the food program for the university students there, and I did some preaching there also. And I was also in Alachua, and I forgot all this town there. But anyway. But Prang Govinda Prabhu wants me to come. He's a sannyas candidate. I'm a member of the ministry for sannyas, and he wants me to come. Let's see, next year maybe. That I inform you when I would be able to come there. Let's see what Krishna's plan is.
Yeah, nice. I hope you can make it. I'm sure you'll really like the program that we do here.
Okay. Okay. So that thank you very much.
Hare Krishna, everyone.
Hare Krishna, Prasanna Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Bhakti Prabhav Maharaj.
Hare Krishna.
Accept my humble obeisances. I joined a few minutes ago and it felt like I've fallen into a pot of nectar. Suddenly, hearing you all are so fortunate. was fortunate to hear the Bhagavatam and discuss the Bhagavatam so nicely every day. I really felt like I've fallen into a pot of nectar. So I'm feeling blissful right now. Thank you so much, Maharaj. You've been with us for quite a while, and we are looking forward always to more association. Thank you for taking time from your very busy schedule and all your other engagements for teaching. I'm happy to hear that you're going to travel, because this means your health is good, means your health is better, and you are able to do all these things.
Yeah, by Krishna's mercy, hopefully I can continue. But of course, this is the last day of this section, but I'm already preparing chapter 80, Sudam, Vipra, and I'm already in the commentaries of the Acharyas, preparing these chapters. It's always, it's teaching or facilitating the course for 1 month, but it's 3 months preparations. It is something that it's not interrupted, it's just continuing.
Very good.
I'm happy with that engagement, because I love the Bhagavatam, it's my life. And I'm very grateful for this opportunity to have Srila Prabhupada in that.
Well, we are equally grateful that you are facilitating this course and interacting with all the students and taking care of the assessment as well. So we are extremely grateful for that. And so we wish you all the best, Maharaj, on your tour and whatever you are doing. We have all our best wishes. And yes, please come back soon. We'll definitely schedule you for the next session. I think everybody's voting favorably.
Yeah.
And Burijan Prabhu is certainly most pleased that you have taken up this. You know, it was his instruction to you. So he's very, very pleased that you are doing that service.
Thank you. Very good.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.